I remember meeting you years and years ago when you started Kids for Tigers. And today you are the president and CEO of the Wildlife Conservation Trust, and you have done some amazing work as a carnivore biologist on education, on climate change, on prey-predator relationship studies, and you've also authored some books. So tell us a little bit about your journey and tell us about what you've done. It's been such an interesting few years on this, a lifetime actually.
Thank you, Latika, for inviting me to talk about my favorite subject. It's a lifetime really, but it started when I was very young and I started rescuing wildlife when I was in the 8th standard. It started with a snake. And then I pretty much, thanks to being in Bombay looks like it's being portrayed as a concrete jungle, but people will be surprised to know that an average Bombayite can see about 40 species of birds, nearly 10 to 12 species of snakes, and some of us who live in the northern part of the city can always stumble upon a leopard. So being in Bombay, I was not very far from forest really. And so, I think Sanjay Gandhi National Park has a big role to play. It's right in the heart of Bombay city. It is, in fact, Bombay is unique to have a national park of the size of Sanjay Gandhi National Park right in the middle. It's about 103 square kilometers, more than 50 species of mammals, about 50 species of, or 40 plus species of herpetofauna. Nearly 750 to 800 species of flowering plants. Obviously, the apex predator leopard, it has probably the highest density of leopards on earth. And so, when I joined college and I would run off to the jungle alone on my friend's motorcycle and in the evenings and spend time tracking wildlife, back then, the attacks on human beings was unheard of. The forest was far more intact. The degradation was not there, and I had some fantastic 3 years of pretty much going to the forest every alternate days. So that's how it started. So my first love, I think, was congenital, but I started catching snakes, rescuing them, and then slowly moved towards leopards. And I'm not surprised that I'm kind of right now for the last nearly 20 years involved with large carnivores. Conservation of large cats in India. As Wildlife Conservation Trust, we work on large landscapes involving tigers, lions, leopards. We also do a little bit of work in the snow leopard landscape, but primarily these three large cats is what we focus on. And as everybody knows, tiger is just a flagship species. By talking about these large carnivores, we are trying to safeguard large landscapes which are replete with thousands of plants and animals, and also most importantly repository for water, because India, being such a big country with so many human beings and so many people dependent on agriculture and fisheries, if our hydrology of our landscape is hampered, we will have a very, very tough time in terms of providing livelihoods to so many million people. So unless we have good quality forests, we will not have happy people. And without happy people, you have social unrest, which then boils down to law and order situations. And you can get warlike situations in no time. So conservation really for India is no less than what the defense forces are doing to protect the boundaries of our nation. And so large carnivores really are just it's a metaphor for all life on earth. And the Wildlife Conservation Trust is trying to use hardcore science to address these issues, because more often than not, conservation conversation or the debate is centered around why wildlife when there are so many poor people. We don't look at it like that. We think economy and ecology are one and the same. In fact, economy is dependent on ecology. So we don't look at economy versus ecology. We say economy and ecology. And I think tiger helps us to say that story in a beautiful way, because you cannot conserve tigers without involving a large number of people. People, not only those people who share their backyards with tigers, but the forest department, whose responsibility it is to protect those protected areas and tiger reserves, and also the policy makers, the decision makers, oftentimes local politicians, and of course the scientific fraternity and the students, because a lot of what we do inspires the next generation, and we have a battery of young people who want to work as interns and volunteers with us. So we have a multi-pronged approach, but we are dealing with pretty much all stakeholders. And it brings me immense pleasure to say that in the last 11 years, we as Wildlife Conservation Trust learned a lot from the landscape. And at the same time, we have not wasted that time to learn. While we were learning, we were also interacting and disseminating information in a very scientific manner. Because unless you use science, people generally put it in the back burner, saying that, oh, this guy always will talk about tigers because he loves tigers, or he talks about lions or leopards or whatever. But when you start talking science, then everybody who's listening to you, including the common man and the decision makers, they start understanding what you're saying, because you are talking not from your heart, but you are using an amalgamation of heart and the assessment of the situation through something which is very robust, and you can't really question what the science is throwing at us. So with climate change, that's has hit mankind in a very big way, and is threatening us in many ways than one can imagine, far more intensely than the COVID-19 situation that we are in. While we are reacting to COVID-19, we are pretty much oblivious to, many of us are oblivious to the impacts of climate change. And so I think this 11 years that WCT has spent will not go waste. It will probably provide some great insights into how you can run conservation models that take into consideration the economy of the nation as well. So I think a lot of work needs to be done, but what we already have done is by no means a small piece in the puzzle that we are in. And I hope that in the decades to come, we are able to enlighten many more people, and also help the government chart out a pathway which is energy efficient, and which takes into consideration the need of human beings, without shortchanging the need of the natural ecosystems. So
fantastic.
So that's in the crux, in short, what I think keeps me ticking, and whatever I say and do is obviously a good mix and of whatever the teams are doing on the ground. A lot of information that I'm going to share today are information collected by young women and men of our team, who are raring to go out there. They feel very claustrophobic during these difficult times, and so one has to keep them busy, otherwise they're going to go mad, because they are people, like free souls, who want to be out there walking into the jungle.
Yeah, absolutely. So I discovered there's a term for it, huh, Anish? Officially called in America, nature deficit disorder.
Yes.
That's what we have.
Yeah.
To your presentation.
Okay, fantastic. So I'm going to focus on the use of conservation science in managing habitats and large landscapes. This is what my team and I have been working over the last 11 years. A lot of what you see is obviously the output and the outcomes, but as you can imagine, the number of hours and days and months that the teams have spent in the field cannot be captured on a presentation. So I will straight away jump into how do you translate to the common man and to the policymakers the importance of wildlife for human beings, because while we all like to believe that we do what we do because we love wildlife and the forests and the water bodies, the fact remains that we are all humans and we are doing this not only for wildlife, we are also making sure that humans themselves can survive into the next century without too much hassle. So what you see here, this is a very, very complex, beautiful looking complex a map of the central Indian landscape as it is defined by the government. It includes 8 states. As you can see, when I say 8 states, it doesn't include all parts of those 8 states, but so part of Maharashtra on the Western Ghats doesn't fall part of it. At the same time, Gujarat and Rajasthan also, a small portion of it is included in the central Indian landscape. So these are 8 states. What you see here, the green spots are protected areas. So they could be tiger reserves, they could be national parks, sanctuaries. Many small national parks and sanctuaries, or especially sanctuaries, are not visible because of the scale. But you are actually looking at nearly 150 protected areas and nearly 150 corridors here. So how it is important for people who are listening to understand how this map was made. So this is a composite image where layers have been overlaid on each other. What are those layers? There is a layer of the vegetation. So how do you get that layer? You get it from the satellite images. We have collected images from 1970 onwards till date, initially every 10 years, and as we move closer to the present dates, we have reduced the number of gaps that we are having. And so it has the vegetation. It also has the protected area boundaries. It has human habitations, which we obviously figured out looking at night lights, because in the night when the lights are on from the satellite, it's very easy to decipher where the human habitations are. So all the blue parts that you see on this composite map are areas which are dominated by human beings, and that there are hardly any forests there. All the green are, as I said, protected areas. Then we also have a layer of large carnivore presence, primarily tiger data. And these data sets obviously are the All India Tiger Estimation data sets, which are with the Wildlife Institute of India. A lot of areas in Maharashtra and Madhya Pradesh where we work, we have our own data, but which was obviously shared with the Wildlife Institute of India. And we also have information on linear infrastructure here. So when I say linear infrastructure, it means roads, it means railways, it means canal systems, it means so these three primarily. Currently we have not included the power lines, but we are soon going to incorporate that as well. This also includes parts of Eastern Ghats landscape as well. So when you overlay, plus you also have a layer of human interference, that is grazing. You also have a layer of cattle grazing is rampant. India has the highest load of livestock on earth, and many of these animals are free ranging. So they are left into the forest every morning and they are brought back to the corrals in the village every evening. And these herbivores, domestic herbivores, compete with the wild herbivores, so they have a huge impact on the dynamics of wild herbivores in this landscape. So we are looking at herbivore densities and the impact of grazing on it. We are also looking at forest degradation. In some areas the forest has gone down, and that we can figure out looking at the images at an interval of time, maybe in every 10 years or 15 years. And so you know which are those areas where the forest is shown on paper, but when you go on the ground, those are degraded. So when you overlay all these different maps, you get a composite. What you see here, the red lines that you see, are basically, think of them as electricity that is moving from one green area to another green area. The more red or the more intensity of that red, the better it is for the movement of large carnivores. And the better it is for the movement of large carnivores, obviously you know that that area is good enough for many other life forms. So the areas which are yellow are the ones which are highly degraded. They are forests, yet over the period of time, because of anthropogenic pressure, they have got damaged, and therefore the resistance to movement of large carnivore is higher. So as you move towards blue, the resistance to movement goes up, which means if it is red, the tigers and leopards and other animals can move easily. As it becomes fainter, the resistance to movement goes up. So this gives us a broad picture of about 150 corridors that exist. But if you look at the date, the maps that the government is using currently, you will see that the number of corridors are which are earmarked as tiger corridors in central India are a very small proportion of the of what you see on this map. Now the problem with that is that whenever there is a developmental project like a dam or a mine, the project proponent will go and look at what exists in the documents with the government, and they will see that many of these red areas are not even marked as corridors in the existing map. And so they will go and propose a project. When that project eventually comes to the forest department, because they are still forest areas, is when everybody wakes up and there is confusion, because the forest department knows that those areas where the dam or a mine or a road is coming are areas where they see wildlife on a daily basis. But because on the main map those areas are not mentioned as corridors, there is a huge amount of conflict between the project proponents, that is the economic and the ecology. So we thought at WCT it will be important to really map this in a far more detailed and a more scientific manner, where we don't look at the least cost paths, which means when I say least cost path, you can understand, see my cursor here. So this is Pench and Kana. This corridor actually is a crooked corridor, plus there is this area below Kana. But if you draw just a thin line between Pench and Kana that follows the forest path, that is a huge understatement when it comes to corridor, because a corridor is not just the vegetation, it is also farmlands. There are so many rivers which the animals are using. So one has to not simplify the science behind corridors. So this basically, what we are trying to say is, this is what you have to look at, not those flimsy thin lines that connect the tiger reserves currently that is there. So we are urging the government to look at this map, and in the future, whenever there is any developmental projects or linear infrastructure project, they need to overlay those projects with these this map, so that they know whether those projects are viable. When I say viable, I think any developmental project is inviable if the damage it causes to the environment is much greater than the profits the government is going to earn. And so we are urging the policymakers to start looking at development as an integral part of the ecosystem and not as something outside of it. So this is the base map that we urge that people should use. Although when you have so many different corridors that exist, there is some amount of pressure on the government. Therefore, to avoid this is not easy. But because there is this problem of avoidance, I think people will use science and technology in a much better way. So when you have everything coming to you easily, you normally don't try to become better in the way you do it, but with constraints, the best technology and efforts come out. So I think rather than diluting the base map, it is important to make it as complex and as real as possible, so that all agencies involved put their best foot forward. So that's the idea, and all our work at WCT, this is our so to say the base map, and all our interventions on the community side. So we work very closely with the forest department and the state government, and with the community. So all our community interventions are in those red areas that you see outside the protected areas, because we think that the protected areas and the tiger reserves, a lot of effort has gone, and pretty much at least a majority of the parks in Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, and also some parts in Rajasthan, they are repositories of wildlife and they are pretty much safeguarded. The most of our efforts in the coming two decades, I think, will have to be in the forests which are outside the protected area network. And so all our efforts as our organization, we are putting on forested areas outside the PA network of India. Even our interventions on protected areas are based on this map, because if there is, say, a Taroba, which you can see here, and from Taroba, if you go to Kanha, the Kanha is obviously in another state, but if you see, there are a lot of green marks right in between Kanha and Taroba. So these are other tiger reserves, Umret Karanla, there is Bor, there is Navegao Nangzira. So as WCT, we want to strengthen the forest departments of those parks, because if a tiger has to move from Taroba to Kanha, it's not going to go by the least path that's available. It will go like a projectile in many directions and eventually land up in Kanha. When it leaves Taroba, it doesn't leave Taroba thinking that it's going to go to Kanha. It could end up in Kawal, it could end up in any place in Chhattisgarh. So, but if we kind of create that path, we know these are the existing paths and where the bottlenecks are, we put our efforts. If I have to work on a village community, I would work in those villages which are in the bottlenecks. So all those constrictions that you see on the red are where we will put our efforts in, so that we can use our limited money to the fullest. And we also urge the government to do the same. For instance, then once we have that base map, we can use GIS to do a lot of other things. For instance, this is a road that is passing. This is Taroba. What you see, the dark green is the southernmost tip of Taroba, and the violet line that you see is the buffer zone. So this is the core, the dark green, and the buffer zone. And there is a road that cuts through the buffer zone. This is nearly 40 kilometers of road, and this is a state highway. And obviously there was a proposal that this highway be widened, because of obviously they're projecting that the traffic will go up in the future and that it will increase the speed of the vehicle on these roads. So when the department came to us saying that there is going to be a proposal like this, we were already camera trapping in these areas for many years. So we put cameras. No other road has been camera trapped the way this road and some of the other roads have, because WCT was approached the department. Some of these officers, young officers from the forest department, came to us and we started camera trapping on both sides of the road. And this camera trapping we did for more than a year, and because of that we were able to find very, very fine grain information on which all spots are critical for what species. So on this map you see on the left there is a tiger. So the left map is on the tiger, and we also looked at Dhol, because different animals use different areas. So we cannot just mitigate for the tiger and forget about the gaur and the other, like sambar. Tiger generally is far more robust in terms of travel. They do travel on busy roads as well, but herbivores, we have figured out from camera trapping, they come to the edge of the road and return. So roads act as a big barrier for herbivores. Obviously there are barriers for tigers and other carnivores, but for herbivores it's like a mount improbable. They just cannot cross it. And so we have created these maps for several species and multiple seasons, because when you do research, if you just go, and mostly what happens is when a project comes to the ministry invites an organization to go and do an environment impact assessment, or the project proponent can themselves go and ask a scientific body to do an EIA. And normally young researchers with limited knowledge on conservation biology are put on the task. They go for 15 days in some season, whichever is convenient at that point in time, and collect some small data. And they do a lot of interviews. They say, we can't do the entire year because we don't have the time. So let's go and talk to people. And when you start taking interviews, it is very subjective. Somebody says a tiger walk from there. You can't build a highway or elevated highway for 40 kilometers because it's economically unviable. As a result, what happens is the data is bad quality. It is not collected in a completely robust scientific, following scientific protocols. And then they come up with a solution, which obviously is a burden, and because there is not enough information, what researchers will suggest is to build much longer over or underpasses. Now that obviously the project proponents will not agree to, because it becomes very expensive to do. And so there is always a conflict, and the project gets delayed, and every month of delay builds on to the exchequer's pressure, builds a lot of pressure on the finances. All the projects that get delayed actually end up spending 1.5 times more money. So instead of that, if we had information well in advance all throughout the year for different species, we have seen that you can really, really reduce. So if you can see here, this is Taroba again, and below this is another very, very good quality forest called Kanhargaon, and these are the different roads. So there are two lanes, so all the yellow, black are two lanes, all the blue, black are four lanes, and all the red and black are roads with in principle approval. So these are all roads that are going to get widened. And you can see that Taroba becomes an island if all these roads widen without any mitigation. But because the department informed us well in advance, and because we could do more than a year of camera trapping in a very detailed, unbiased manner, there is so much good quality data that when we had meetings with senior officials from the PWD and also in the chief minister's office, we were able to convince them to actually include 28 mitigation structures onto these roads. And that's a big thing, because nowhere in India something like this has happened, where state highways are going to be built with the mitigation structures on it. The work has not yet started, but I'm sure, and obviously there will be some amount of money that will be required for those, but the government has assured us that they will do everything possible. If there is no money with the PWD or the highway authorities, then the state government is willing to put the money for this, and there is a very good guideline that the Wildlife Institute of India has already come out with. So we have also stuck to what the guideline is suggesting in terms of road. So if a minimum of 300 meters of underpass, when I say underpass, whenever we talk about mitigation structures, we are talking from the animal's perspective. So underpass means the animals go below it, which means it's a bridge. So an underpass of about 300 meters, or in some cases where there are two such underpasses required, but they are very close to each other, then you could have a 700 meter underpass. So such structures have been suggested, and there was no argument on either side. When we proposed and we showed all the hard data, it was very easy for the government to act. And so this is the success of conservation science. We've also, because of camera trapping, it's not just for counting tigers and leopards and stuff. Obviously, that we do, and it is of great help at the national level to have a repository. It also gives every state a figure that they need to maintain or improve upon. So it's very good to do that kind of stuff. But there is so much data that is available, which goes unused. So in WCT, we are camera trapping in lot of these, as I said, outside protected areas. So this to the left is Nagzira, and the lavender color patch you see is Navegaon. So people who know of Nagzira Navegaon Tiger Reserve, many who are not from Maharashtra or have visited there will not know that they are not connected to each other. So it's like Dudhwa Tiger Reserve, where Katarnya Ghat, Dudhwa National Park and Kishanpur are actually three different areas, and they are all connected through corridors. So because of our work, we could actually map all this compartment wise. So if you see here, there are compartments. So this on the right is Bor Tiger Reserve. It used to be 60 square kilometers. Without hardly without no buffer was notified. But because of our work, and obviously the forest department was in the process of declaring or notifying the buffer zones, and also but at that point, because our data was there and it was rich data compartment wise, we could share, and so we could leave a certain villages and those areas out, so to minimize conflict with people. And it obviously helped the forest department to demarcate the buffer zones. So if you do long term science, following all the robust protocols, you can advise the government, and therefore all the boundaries that are drawn are keeping in mind the current situation and the future problems that can come in. So in the past, a lot of national parks and sanctuaries have got declared, and because at that point it was done not in a very scientific manner, lot of communities have felt alienated, and they are sanctuaries on paper, but on the ground there is no acceptance, and therefore those sanctuaries are sometimes worse off than some of the non-protected areas of India. So science can help in advising the state government also at the center as to how you want, if you are designing a buffer zone, what should be the shape so that the future conflict between people and the forest department can be reduced. Similarly, this is Taroba and Indravati, and we have kind of created this huge comp, and you can see it's all compartment wise through GIS work, and so these are all the forested areas which we have shared, and now they become part of the tiger conservation plan. So the TCPs that every tiger reserve has to make, initially they were asked to, many years back, they used to give a plan for the tiger reserve, but for there is it's mandatory for all the field directors to create TCPs, that is tiger conservation plans, which will also include management of the buffer zone and the corridors. So because of this work, these maps have now been are part of the TCP, and therefore the field director feels responsible for all the areas outside, and he or she knows exactly what has to be done in those areas. So science also helps the day-to-day management of the buffer zones which are outside tiger reserve. On the other hand, we all know that the radio telemetry work that is being done for several years, in India it was started on tigers, where Ullas Karant actually radio collared a few tigers in Karnataka. That was a seminal work, and a huge amount of information came out of it. Understanding of tigers went up, the understanding of ecology of tigers. Camera trapping can tell you things about distribution, can tell you densities, but unless you radio collar animals, you don't know how a tiger behaves on a hourly basis or a minute by minute basis. And so we know what they eat, we know how much they rest, we know how important the water is for a tiger. So currently we use radio telemetry, again in very close conjunction with the state department. We don't do research projects to understand how a tiger family is behaving. I think there is enough and more knowledge on behavior of tiger as a species. We don't need more data on it. What we need is all those animals that are reintroduced in some landscape, or animals that are dispersing, we want to know how those animals are moving, because whatever we do with camera trapping doesn't give us information on the behavior of individuals. So whenever an animal is captured because it is either strayed too far out, or it is got into potentially into a conflict-like situation, departments, when they go and capture that animal, they inform our researchers, and we go and help the veterinary team of the forest department to put radio collars, so that we can monitor that particular individual, and a huge amount of information comes out of it. You can see the camera traps in the backdrop, and this male tiger has killed a boar in the wild. So when a tiger starts getting habituated, it moves slowly away from domestic prey. This tiger was moving very dangerously close to a village, and it was taking livestock on a daily basis. When it is reintroduced into another landscape, it will find it difficult to go for a much more difficult proposition, that is wild prey. But when you have the radio collar, you can actually go out there and see what the tiger is doing. Whenever the tiger starts getting immobilized, you know that it may have made a kill, and it gives you an assurance that the tiger has started getting habituated. So for instance, on the right hand side, you see the map. This is Satpura Tiger Reserve. The top red spot is where the tiger was captured. It was human habitation, and then it was released inside Satpura Tiger Reserve, and it was constantly monitored with a radio collar along with the Madhya Pradesh Forest Department. As you can see, there's the release site here, and the red spots are all the kills, the wild kills that the tiger was habituated to go for domestic cattle when it was outside. But when it was released in an area, again, where to release? Because we have done camera trapping inside Satpura Tiger Reserve, we knew which are those areas which are good for tigers and have very few tigers there. So that information that is available with the Forest Department, thankfully every year the department does the camera trapping. So those maps, when you look, you know which are the best sites, because the site that you think is good may not be good because there is water and prey, there would already be a resident tiger there, and you don't want to create a confusion between tigers by releasing. So human beings should stop playing God. They should use the science, and the science will tell them that within Satpura, which is the area where if this new male tiger is released, the conflict between him and other existing males or females with cubs will be minimal. And these are anyways at the end of the day experiments, because you can never be sure how that tiger is going to behave. So we need to constantly keep doing this, and there will always be a few tigers that will defy logic, but still it is better to go blindfolded than with some information. So this tiger, as you can see, started killing gaur, sambar, and there was one stray cattle also that he killed. But this gives us a lot of assurance. Then on the right hand side, you can see these are the different tracks per season. You can also know the same tiger, how it is moved away from water, how it is. So you get to know the behavior of the animal in different seasons. In summer, tigers can walk much more. However, they are limited by the amount of water available. In monsoon, there is water everywhere, so they don't have to worry about water. So in fact, in monsoon, they can really go on longer walks. In summer, they unless they are marking territories, they don't do too much of walking, because A, they get exhausted, B, there is no guarantee that there is water everywhere. So they are far more localized. So within the territory also, it will spend more time near water bodies. So there are very straight direct movements from water body to water body during summer. So all those information keeps improving our knowledge and the knowledge of the frontline forest staff, because whatever we do is shared on almost immediately with the Forest Department. Similarly, we are doing the first ever, we have in India, the first ever telemetry work on pangolin has been done by WCT. You can see one of our researchers on that beautiful landscape in Satpura. And you can imagine it's almost impossible to track tigers here and to actually go and track pangolin. So technology really has helped us, and we are able to put, you can see a device here on the plate of the pangolin, and the pangolin is giving some fascinating information, and a lot of it is counterintuitive to even somebody like me who reads a lot of research paper, because there was some work done on pangolin in Africa, but really nothing in India, so there was no background information. So when it was released, we were like school kids, all the people within WCT, we would kind of try to find out what this female is doing. We now have two females that have been radio collared, and this is the fascinating information that you can get out of GIS work. So on the left hand side, you actually have the elevation also, and you can see that the pangolin has really walked covered a lot of area, and as a crow flies, our animal has actually gone more than 23 kilometers in a few days. On some occasions, they don't walk much, but on other days, they do walk. Their activity span is also very unique. Unlike what most people believe, they are not active all throughout the night. They come out for a very short period of time. Because their food is abundant, they really don't have to spend too much time seeking food. So that food is super abundant. So they go out and they can finish their eating rapidly, and then they are back into the burrow, but that burrow could be some other burrow, not the same burrow. You can see they have actually climbed large mountains also, and spent, and this is that one animal that was released has actually crossed, traversed so much, and in such an undulating terrain. It's fascinating information that comes, how it burrows, how much area is required by the individual animal. So this is a evolving science, and as we radiocollar more, as we tag more individuals and in different habitats, we will have some fascinating information, which eventually for us, again, this we are doing to see how the species behaves and how we can put conservation protocols in place so that the forest department can effectively conserve these kind of animals. Because while we use tiger as the as a symbol and we protect large landscapes, but pangolin, through our camera trapping outside protected areas, we know that they are pretty much distributed all throughout the forest, even in degraded forests. So this knowledge that we have and that we'll share with the departments will help us in creating a protocol to protect that species and not hope to protect that species by protecting the tiger. So sometimes it doesn't work, like you have seen in a lot of species that are found in grasslands, that tiger conservation has not really helped those species. In fact, some of these species have got threatened because of the tiger, hyenas, wolves, all those which are grassland, because there is that feeling, and not now, but at least about 20 years, 30 years ago, where a lot of afforestation drives were done and grasslands were wrongly converted into woodlands, which really destroyed the habitat of a species like caracal and several other grassland species. So so it's wrong to believe that wild tiger is great in terms of protecting large landscape, but within that landscape, if you want to protect enigmatic species like the pangolin or the rattle, then we may need very good information about those species, and science is going to help us to do that. This again is very dear to all of us involved in research in WCT. So this is the underpass in on the corridor between Page and Navegaon Nagzira. On the left hand side of the road, that is where my cursor is the Page Maharashtra Tiger Reserve. On the right hand side is the territorial forest. And this road is actually along the border of the tiger reserve in Maharashtra, but as the road goes up north, it actually passes through the tiger reserve. There on the left hand side is the core of Madhya Pradesh Panch, on the right hand side is the buffer zone. So in a stretch of nearly 10 plus kilometers, this highway actually which is NH7 in the past, now NH44, actually cuts through the tiger reserve. So because of the work that several organizations have done, WII had come and done a lot of surveys, suggested the mitigation measures, our work on tigers and the distribution and how the highway was acting as an impediment. The old two-lane highway itself was an impediment for movement of tigers. The tigers to the left of the road were not interacting with tigers to the right, so there were two separate populations. Only the males would crisscross, the females would hardly cross. That's what our data set shows. So when we went and spoke, in fact, to the Chief Minister of Maharashtra, and I actually showed the results, and he was completely flabbergasted to see how a small road. So I at that point told him that, see, the current road is actually an impediment, but and you are widening this road. If there are no mitigation measures, then there is no way animals can move. But if we can provide mitigation measures, we can actually undo the damage that the two-lane road has been doing. So with this mitigation, in fact, now the population is far more connected than it was when it was two lane. But in this case, it is true. However, that doesn't mean that any road that cuts through any forest is good for wildlife. We still very strongly believe that all the existing two lanes or the smaller roads that are passing through our protected areas or our tiger reserves should remain two lane. They should not be expanded. However, all those roads which are two lane outside the protected areas along the corridors can be expanded with proper mitigation measures, and they should not be treated as a stepchild, because normally territorial forest means you don't need to do research, there is hardly animal. But we must remember that 30-40 years ago we had given up on tigers. There were a lot of documentaries made during that era where presenters said that the Tigers are not going to see the next return of century, but actually Tigers have done better now than before. So there is no reason to give up on the territorial forests, which are degraded currently, because if the policy changes, if people understand the importance of forest for the water and for themselves, there is no reason to believe that these areas are going to go. In fact, they will be better 20 years later than they are now. And at that point, if you have not put the mitigation structures now, you will have problems. And so I think all those areas outside protected areas, which are either buffer or corridors, have to be treated like top habitats and mitigated for the future. Because we always think in the present and we never plan infrastructure for the future. And the science that is there, that rich body of work done through several research organizations and individuals, has to be utilized. Otherwise, research and conservation will remain two separate entities. We need them to talk to each other. So this project is one great example. We have started measuring now that the highway is there. We don't think that the problem is over. This was just a suggestion. Obviously, ideally, the highway shouldn't have been there. But because the highway was there, even before the Tiger Reserve came in, it got sanctioned. And now that it is wide, we need to understand how the traffic volumes are, how the animals are behaving in those stretches where there are no mitigation structures. So there are these methods in which by your tubes, etc., where you can actually keep measuring the number of vehicles going on it to get the flow of traffic in the day, in the night. We also put sensors where you can detect noise, because roads are visible to us, but for animals who are far more sensitive than us, even sounds are a big dampener. And so many of these animals don't even come to the road because of the constant hiss of the vehicles and the honking of the thing. And based on those sound detectors, which we have planted below the existing highways and also inside the forest, we are and we have camera traps, so we know the intensity of sound and the usage of habitat by these animals. So again, science is helping us to understand, go one step further. We don't think that a solution once provided is enough. We think we have to evolve, and there are enough these experiments that we have done in terms of this suggesting these in underpasses and overpasses also have to be studied, so that in the future it can be more effective. There could be these kind of sound barriers. In the Madhya Pradesh side of the NH-44, they have accepted that these sound barriers are required at least 3 meters and some places even 4 meters. But in Maharashtra, which obviously the road is already there, there are no sound barriers as yet. So this kind of studies will prove, and I am sure that once we come up with our suggestions based on our study, the highway authorities will easily put up these sound barriers based on what my understanding is from the past. We also look at velocity of vehicles, because it's not just how many vehicles, it's also at what speeds. Rather than talking about that all roads are bad and vehicles should go at this speed, let us go and find out what the data is talking. Video footage also to understand behavior of animals. So it's not just camera traps sometimes don't give you the entire picture. So if there is an opening in the road, and if this is being used by animals, then we want to know how they behave. So how many minutes do they stand on the side, and whether they cross where there is good amount of shoulder or they cross where there is thicket, because all those information will come handy when we are suggesting that there should be no plantation in the dividers, that they have to have a clear sight of both edges, how much area we must clear on the side of the road so that animals don't get startled by a fast moving vehicle. So all those studies are going on. Camera traps not only below but also in insignificant looking underpasses, because these small little culverts are also conduits for movement for a lot of species. Like a sloth bear can easily go from here, although it requires a larger area, but it will go. Small snakes, frogs and a lot of other species. So we don't want to focus just on large carnivores. As you can see from the photos given below, there are that the tigers and the wild dogs have already started using the underpasses. Gaur has also started. This is very important. Tiger dogs, as I said, carnivores are far more robust in terms of the way they think. But herbivores, when they start using, I think the mitigation measure can be certified as effective when herbivores move. And so this is a good thing. Sound also affects them. So we are constantly correcting data and more data. Finally, I would take about 3-4 minutes to say that this was the science that we use on the wildlife side. But there is huge amount of science that needs to go when it comes to the communities and the people who interact with wildlife. So this is just one case study in Chandrapur district in the Brahmapuri area, which is very, very good in terms of tiger densities, but also highly dense in terms of human population. So when we go and measure parameters from in villages, you can see we don't do small work. We don't do 5 villages, 1 village. We cover large areas so that we take into consideration the heterogeneity that is there, heterogeneity that is there in the population. We don't want to do simplified pilots which are not scalable. We need to take all the problems into consideration. So we collect up to 800 parameters per family, and we look at thousands of households. So you can see 183 villages are sampled. 8,300 households within those 183 villages, and we covering nearly 40,000 people. So then that data set is very robust. What is existing with the government, sometimes it is outdated. We don't know the methods that have been used. So we don't want to base our recommendations to the government on data which we are not sure of. So we go out there and collect big data, and we figured out very, very counterproductive things. We keep saying that livelihood is very good for reducing the conflict. In a way it is, however it is just part of the story. What is important that when you understand the socioeconomics of the landscape, so say this is a territorial forest outside to the east of Tadoba Tiger Reserve. The village which had higher incomes actually were not so cooperative when it comes to conservation. In fact, the consumption also of wood was higher than villages with lower incomes. So it is counterintuitive. Somebody says that you provide livelihood and the problem is solved. No, you should provide livelihood definitely so that people can get educated, they can take their decisions well. But that is just the beginning. You need to constantly interact with them so that their behavior slowly changes. They understand that the forest is their mother. If the forest goes, their agriculture will fail. There will be huge amount of human wildlife interactions which are going to be detrimental to their own well-being. So we can't look at just one part of the jigsaw. You have to look at the entire jigsaw. And sometimes when we are actually analyzing things, we have to use again technology, machine learning, to identify drivers for firewood usage. So it's not as simple as you think. You have to go and collect what our camera traps shows, pictures of people carrying headloads. We do interviews which are not pure interviews, typical interviews where you go and ask how much wood you collect. These are, we make them play games to see their association with the forest, their association with the forest department, and decipher what they are trying to say. It's not on questionnaire, because questionnaires have a big limitation, because sometimes you will get the answers that you want out of a questionnaire, because the person who is asking the question is leading the person who is being questioned. And so we stay away from there. We do complex studies, and unless you really understand good quality statistics, it's impossible to do. Fortunately, the teams are equipped to do that. There is again dependency that we are. So for instance, this was about firewood. When you collect, you know that the top quartile consumes twice as much of firewood as the bottom quartile, which means the people who have more money are actually consuming much more. So it's, you can see, so this, if you see the quartile 4, when the income is much higher, are people who are consuming much more. And how do you measure consumption? It is not the number of kgs, it is the amount of minutes. So we ask them how much time they cook or how much time they are using fire in the house. So it's minutes per person, not because people, if you ask me what is the weight of this jug, I will say some random figure, and it depends on my understanding of it. So we don't do that. We try to be as practical as possible when we understand, and then we try and figure out what is the perception there. We try to make sure what are the reasons under which people are collecting it. Why are they exposing themselves to large carnivores? Why are they exposing themselves to conflict with the forest department for something like wood? And once you start talking, you realize that some of it is culture, some of it is because of poverty, and some of it is just casual. So each one has a different solution and each one has to be addressed separately. So we start working on understanding the psychology of a group rather than individual's psychology. So that kind of study, so we have people who understand economy, psychology, and the way the developmental sector is behaving. So that team works along with our conservation biologists to come up with models, and we have come up with solutions. Like, so we realized from our study that that the fuel wood that is being used by people largely is going in heating water. So when the government program or a scheme that the government comes out to give subsidized LPG gas cylinders for cooking, and they think that because we have given it to 30,000 families and each family was using 10 kgs of wood every day, because we have given 30,000 connections, we are saving 30,000 into 10 kgs every single day, and in a year so many 100 tons of wood gets saved. That is a very simple back of the hand calculation. That's not how it pans out. In fact, from all the wood that is collected, nearly 60 to 65% of that wood is utilized for heating water, because there is cultural fixation on having a hot water bath every day, and we understand their body is aching, there are a lot of insect bites. So it's always, even when the temperatures are 45 degrees, men and women who work in the field, they come out and they want a hot water bath, and therefore the hot water is constantly being there. So there is a big bowl which burns all day and the water gets heated. So when we actually went and did some R&D on existing water heaters, initially we thought we'll give a community heater, but we said no, because community heaters will be at one spot. We didn't want kids and the people to get burned by actually queuing up for hot water somewhere and then carrying those buckets with them. So we said we'll have to be decentralized solutions is what we'll have to give. And so these kind of things we gave, and you cannot imagine when we started, we didn't know what, because people are not rich here, okay? So there is a financial issue. Eventually, they have all contributed 25% of the cost of the heater, and in several villages, so more than three villages is where we have done, nearly 25% of the population and the families have bought this, because this they can burn with agriculture waste, they don't need wood. So now with LPG cylinder that the government has given and these water solutions that the people have bought, obviously 75% subsidy, but still they have paid money. Because they have paid money, they value it, and we have modified this in such a way that you put water on one side and you can get water on the other side. So you can only, you can heat, you, if you want 1 liter, you pour 1 liter on the top and you will get 1 liter down there. So no wood is going to get wasted. Whenever you burn something, you can only burn it for as much time that you want that water. So it's a very efficient way. We actually modified the but we don't want to patent this. We have not done something out of the world. It's very logical, but you don't get these kind of water heaters outside. These are specifically made now, and the cost has come down half. So it was initially more than 10,000-12,000, now it's about 6,000 rupees. So science can change things in many, many different ways. So this is pretty much what I wanted to say. I've taken up 50 minutes, but I'm now more than happy to talk to you. As you can see, you can always write to me at my, on my email. So I'm back with you, Latika.
Fantastic. Takes me back to my research, because this is exactly what I worked on when I was working in Central India way back in 94. So I actually have lots of data. I don't know if you've been given it by the Wildlife Institute, but I did a lot of this stuff. But amazing. There's been a lot of questions about the efficacy of underpasses versus overpasses. So what would you advocate? Which works better normally?
So that decision is taken by the topography. So first is by the animal. So if the animal wants to walk a certain area, then that is the area. You cannot, so at that area, if it's a flat land, then there is no question of an overpass, because if you want to build an overpass, you will have to take more forest land on both sides, because what will you build it on? So you will have to do some amount of pile up. So you'll have to put some debris there so that the animal can move over. So when I say overpass, means you are wanting the animal to move over the road. Now, so if, on the other side, if you have a mountain and the road is going on the edge of the mountain, then that topography, and if the animal is crossing there often, then naturally that topography is right to build an overpass, for the animal also looks at the contour. So the animal goes on the contour. So if you is a ridge, and if a road is passing, then you can dig the area, the road will go down and the animal will continue to go. So you don't change the contour of the ridge.
So what happens in cases like here, now they're talking about new roads here in Rajasthan, and which are going through, for instance, the border of Ranthambore National Park, and then all across the Chambal as well. And they're talking of elevated roads.
That's an underpass.
But then what about, have you ever studied the effect of doing one of these when in an area like the Chambal, when it actually crosses the river? Have you done any studies on marine?
Latika, these are the first mitigation structures ever built anywhere in the subcontinent, right? Mm-hmm. So data is now coming for the underpass. Data is there. WII is also collecting data there. We are collecting on the sound and lot of other areas outside of this one national highway. So there is a Samruddhi expressway that is being built that will connect Bombay with Nagpur, and it's going to be the speed is going to be 150 kilometers per hour. So there, because it's very high speed, you cannot have a road that keeps going up and down. So they will have to treat that road like a railway, which means when it is on the mountain, they will have to actually excavate and the road will go down. So lot of overpasses are being suggested in those areas, in the areas where you have black buck, you have chinkara, you have wolves. So these current underpasses that you see are in woodland area. That is more like a grassland. So that is going to give us so much information, because and I am part of this committee formed by the government to go and see if the underpasses and overpasses that have been suggested are first adequate in number or at the right place or at the right width. So we have
Years ago we had done a mitigation strategy between Rajaji when it was divided with the Ganga Canal and everything, and they had built these underpasses
on the canal.
Yeah, under the canal, and they actually moved elephant droppings to these areas to get people, you know, the animals to come there. But we found that the male single tuskers would go through, the females with young ones would have a great hesitation in going through.
So I think that was because those studies that were done were not, so logically they were right, but I've also been there, if you see the, it's very narrow. So when you have an underpass, it's not about the height alone, it is also where, how close the walls are. And herbivores feel claustrophobic inside. A, they want to see the sky. So the higher it is, the better. Sometimes in canals, it may not be possible because of gravity and all that. But then if they are, so going in the future, now there's enough knowledge that all these passes will have to be, we have to keep the species in mind. And then the dimensions will change. So you will have to build an underpass and overpass keeping the most impacted species in mind, others or the most adapted or a very very niche specific species. So if I am building an overpass in a wolf habitat, then I cannot go by my understanding of the tiger, because the wolf's definition of the habitat and the open area is there. So if I have a same dimension that I provided for the tiger, for the wolf may just reject it. So there we have to do. So what we have suggested is, in the future, wherever the government is ready, in the Samruddhi Expressway, they are ready to give three different dimensions to it, so that we can collect data, and in the future, we can decide that for a black buck or chinkara or for these dry habitat species, this is what we need. Because otherwise it will be just 15 meters because 15 meters is mentioned somewhere. So we are saying no, do it 30, 45 and 60 meters and then see which is the best used. So in the future, and India is going to build highways left, right and center. So wherever they are going to cut corridors, we can say for sure that if it is for black buck, then it has to be this much. If it is for tigers, and if this is how it should be, and for elephants. So we'll have to do it that way. It cannot, there is no shortcut. It is long, arduous journey, but there is enough and more science. I tell you, we'll have lesser mistakes in the future.
Fantastic. A big concern is, of course, the creation of big dams and the effect of dams on populations. A case in point, a talk that I heard interestingly recently was the new population of tigers in the Dibang Valley, with all the dams being planned there. What is WCT going to be doing on things like this, and how will technologies such as these help us to plan for the inundation of large areas when huge dams are created?
So fortunately, the Dibang battle, which shouldn't have been a battle because it is really illogical to build large dams one after the other on the same river.
Yes.
So you are shortchanging the dams downstream by building a large dam there.
Yes.
There is good research work that has already gone in. So there have been researchers who have collected good amount of data on large carnivores there. So thankfully, but not, there are so many dams that are coming, and yes, not many of those have that kind of rich data set. So in the Dibang battle, I think it's very clear that the tigers are using, the protected areas there are at high elevation. Mm-hmm. And those are large protected areas, so thousands of square kilometers. And so the way the government talks is that, oh, you should be happy that there is such large protected area here. But one must understand that the high elevation is used by tigers in a certain season. The main area, their breeding areas and all those are lower elevation. So if I have two protected areas on the top, but I have nothing on the bottom, those tiger populations are doomed, because they are locally migrating. They will seasonally, they will keep going up and down, and more often than not, they'll use the valleys where there will be a greater number of prey. So that already is available, which means even if you have declared the high, doesn't mean the low is not important. The low is actually more important than the high. High you must protect because there are some niche specific animals. It's not just a tiger, but there are some that live there, only there. But the tiger is a generalist, so I think there is data set available. So WCT, obviously, wherever there is a consultation and any of these researchers have, and my team is all connected because a lot of them are researchers, so they are already interacting with people who have worked in that landscape. I am on the Governing Council of Bombay Natural History Society, that is BNHS. So we are going to come up with a submission. Plus, I am on the NTCA, I'm an NTCA member, so on that committee as well. So definitely, as researchers and people who understand science and also respects the need for development, they have to make their point. And I think I will not be shooting in the dark because there is data available. So I think at various governing bodies, there is enough and more knowledge available on the seismicity of Himalayas and how risky it is to build big dams
What are you proposing? Are you proposing that they scale down dams to make them a series of smaller dams? Are you proposing that some be totally eliminated and only some remain?
Simply put, you don't need hydroelectric power because solar power is much cheaper now than hydroelectric power, and this dam will take some years to build. By then, solar technology would have improved so much that the hydroelectric power will be more expensive. Basically, you will have to subsidize it, which means that you are destroying so much forest, thinking that you are going to benefit the people. Actually, you are going to dampen the economy. So that is one.
But then the argument that this is the Northeast, and with so much of rainfall and so much of the year under cloud cover and such thick vegetation, you will need huge clearings of land for solar power, and the efficiency of solar power will not be really good in that part of the world. I mean, though other parts of India are very good for solar. So then how do you deal with
it? I'm not saying that there needs to be solar power where Dibang is. Dibang and that forest doesn't need solar energy or doesn't need electricity at all. Okay, and if at all there are villages, they obviously will need electricity, but their micro grids, their micro solar power plants will be much smaller. So, and already in the Northeast, when Northeast looks green from the top, but if you have gone there recently, there are a lot of degraded lands there also.
Yes.
And those degraded lands can always be utilized for solar. Even in a village, there is enough open space where solar can be integrated for that village. Now, if that village wants to sell that power to somewhere else, is a different matter. That's a commercial activity. But for that village, they can be self-sufficient with small solar plants. The Dibang power, the hydroelectric power, is not going to supply electricity to just that village.
Oh,
oftentimes we have seen that big dams and big thermal power plants come, but the village which are right at the border of these plants have no electricity.
Yeah.
So let us understand that this dam is for the larger population. A smaller area is being destroyed, and so there is no way a large dam should come in where it is being suggested. Always, and I don't need to repeat myself, and others have said it many times, that smaller dams are much better. America has figured out in a very harsh way. They have actually broken so many such dikes and stuff that they had created that was obstructing water. Your main economy of the rural area is fishing. And if you are building these large dams, you are going to kill that flora. Plus, there is nothing like surplus water on land. All that water that goes into the sea is important for the sea and for the biodiversity there. So, a lot of 30% of Indians are fishing communities. When you build dams and you take the water off the sea, you will kill the estuaries, you will kill the deltas, you will kill the fishery, then all the nurseries that are there. So, there is a cascading effect. Once a dam is built, you will build it on thousands of crores of rupees, and then you will break it and waste thousands of crores of rupees. In both ways, the GDP goes up. So first of all, we must not look at GDP in the way we are. We should look at GDP in a far more holistic way, where we start factoring the negative impact the GDP, or what natural resource is it liquidating to create that kind of money. So at many levels, seismicity, wrong habitat, tigers are going to be completely irreversibly impacted. The forest is going to go, it will snatch away livelihoods for people not there, but many, many kilometers downstream. It will have impact on biodiversity in general. And when, God forsaken, I hope that there is no earthquake there, but as you know, in the last 2 months, there have been so many tremors. Yesterday we had in Kutch, which has no relation with the Northeast, but the ones that you feel in Delhi, they all have epicenters in the Northeast. And if there is an earthquake, you can imagine the kind of devastation that this will do. So it is a complete miscalculation in the term, in the way it is being done. So I think at many levels, we will try and put sense in the proponents that this is detrimental to life in general, and there are better ways of generating electricity.
Okay, so coming back closer to home, the Mumbai issues, the coastal road, and the impact that that's having on your watersheds, on your sea, on the ecology of the region in general. How is WCT involved with that? And
we are not directly involved because we have to focus, and our focus is on landscapes that the large carnivores use, and we are limited in resources and the number of people, so we don't poke our nose everywhere. However, we have opinion, and obviously I was on the state board of wildlife. The state board is getting reconstituted now, and so whatever we can do through these kind of bodies, WCT does. So we can't pick all the battles. However, my personal opinion, and also what we have suggested to some of the bureaucrats, is that Bombay City is thriving, and it is a business hub for the country, because Bombay has good quality water. all of that water comes from national parks and sanctuaries. One is right in the heart of Bombay City, the Sanjay Gandhi National Park. The Tansa Sanctuary is about 100 kilometers away, and there are in fact four dams that get most of the water from the catchment there. So what we are suggesting is that we go in a payment for ecosystem service model, where Bombay pays for the loss of opportunity of people who live in that habitat, and because that habitat is protected, because there are dams there, they have lost their livelihood, they are doing agriculture, but agriculture is not producing the kind of yield, so that is a very inefficient way of doing agriculture. They cannot move to organic because they cannot then compete with the market. So Bombay City, that makes so much profit, if each one of us gives just 60 paisa a day, there will be enough and more money for those people to have a much greener lifestyle, to be far more prosperous, and therefore not degrade the land, which is important for Bombay to survive. So we are looking at models where cities can share their incomes in a, even in a small fractional way, will change the way the land use is happening. So it's all about land use. The coastal road also, as a Bombay City is a financial capital, and certain things has to change, which means that there has to be faster roads, there has to be better connectivity, there is no doubt about that. But whether a coast, destroying the coast is the answer to it, that is the question we have to ask. And to say that this road is going to create more place for corals to grow is not the right thing. So as long as the government understands that there is a damage that this is doing to the environment, and that damage will have to be compensated, not in terms of NPV and rupees like that, but in a very, very different way of a very integral planning of the entire ecosystem of Bombay. When I say ecosystem, I am looking at a radius of about 100 kilometers from Bombay. How can all these things improve the situation there so that there are less number of floods, so that the people who live there have a prosperous lifestyle, and therefore and at the same time don't degrade the forest, because most of these catchment areas are going. Bombay can keep building more dams, but eventually the water has to be in the river, and so the river needs to be strengthened, so the upstream, the deforestation has to stop. For that, Bombay needs to pay for it. So Bombay needs to create that kind of model, and at least WCT has started working on things like this. So we are we don't have knee-jerk. We have seen this problem. We want to provide a solution so that economists there listen to us. Otherwise, they say, "Arey yaar, tum log morcha leke aa jaate ho. What is this? This is not helping us. You give us solutions." So what WCT is doing, from all that has happened in the last 4 or 5 years, we have started on a path where we are going to come up with this plan. And definitely, Bombay is under stress, but there are many more cities in the future that are going to face the same problem. So if we can learn from here, I think we would have more than compensated for the mistakes that were done in Bombay.
Okay, great. One last question. It's not going to be an easy one, but I think a lot of people want to constantly ask this. There is so much talk about climate change. That's one of the most important issues today. Can you tell us the impact of climate change on large carnivores in the areas that you work in, what you think the problems can be, and what we need to look out for?
So it is not difficult, in fact. So climate change, what does climate change do? Climate change makes drier habitats drier, dry habitats drier, wet habitats wetter. It makes seasonal changes very erratic. So you will have monsoon, which is spread out now across 5 months. When it should rain heavily, it doesn't rain, but it rains in summers. So that has impact on agriculture. When you have impact on agriculture, there are losses to people. Obviously, then those poor people have no other place to go but go to the forest. So climate change, that puts pressure on economy and livelihoods of people, and people then get forced to go and cut the forest or depend on the forest more. Bushmeat, that is killing herbivores, trapping, or sometimes even hunting carnivores for sale. Carnivore has no market here, but lot of poaching still happens, and some of it will obviously go all the way to China. in Vietnam and all these countries. But hunting on the ground just for bushmeat can go up because of the impact or on the economy. Then forest fires. So when you have fires now, they are far more intense than they used to be in the past because of the changing humidity and the soil moisture. You can see what has happened in Australia. We have never seen those kind of fires in many, many decades now. All over the world, in India, unfortunately, most of our forests burn twice because they are all man-made fires. We don't have natural fires as such, but man-made fires so that the fodder can go up for the free grazing cattle. And some of these fires escape and they devastate forests. In Nagarhole, you see it. In most of our even protected areas, every year some patch or the other burns. The audience should know that they are not natural fires. What you see in California and some of these areas where there are pine and eucalyptus in Australia, it's a different thing altogether. Whereas here, it is all a man-made. So that fire is more intense. It is destroying the habitat. Then because of climate change and because of poverty, you will need and the depleting water. The surface water is important. As I said, 65% of Indians are farmers. And if the amount of water that flows in our rivers is progressively going down, and if it continues to do so, the government will be forced to compensate for that by building more dams. So if you need more water because your agriculture doesn't have enough from the river, then you dam the river and you try. So this is a stopgap, not a good idea, but the government is forced to, because otherwise how can you get votes from people who are unhappy because of water? So they will have to go. So fire intensity is higher, water is going down because of degradation of the forest, because of anthropogenic pressures, more dams will come. So as a result, you will have increasing fragmentation. People want to connect the cities because they want to provide jobs again, because jobs are connected to climate change in many ways. So people who have good productivity, say up in the mountains also, now fruiting trees are not fruiting the way they used to be, or the fruiting line has shifted. So when that happens and you own land, your land is fixed. And if because of climate change, the productivity of the land goes, because the productivity increases somewhere else, you cannot move your land there. So you lost it. When that happens, your financial conditions goes down and you go to the city. And that's why the government will have to build more roads. People are intermingling with each other for livelihood. So all those things are working. So climate change per se is not one single thing. Climate change is an entire process which was set in motion 225 years back by the Western world, because at that point they were developing like how India is developing today. So there is no difference, and we can't call them the villains, because we ourselves, out of our aspirations, are developing at a pace which they did about 200 years ago. So what we are doing is what they did. But what we don't understand is that when they did, the population densities were so low that they could manage it. Now, because climate change is only getting worse, the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere is more than 400 parts per million. And the impact on weather, on cyclones, all that is so much. Now, if we follow the same trajectory as the West did, it is going to hamper our country more than anything else, because India's strength is social capital. 35 years and below constitute 65% of all Indians. And if those people are going to be unemployed, if those people are going to suffer because of disease, famine and all those, you think there will be no social unrest? There will be social unrest. There will be law and order situation. There will be refugee-like situation. Already you see a lot of people coming in from Bangladesh into India because of the conditions that are there. So India already has their own issues. And because of the environment and climate change, these issues of a lot of islands, a lot of other villages are happening on a daily basis within the country. Don't think of India as one country. Think of a large city as one, a village which is 100 kilometers away as another place. And the people there are so dissatisfied that they are trying to move to the city where the city is already saturated. So this is going to happen over and over again in a much larger proportion. So I think in all these, tiger will actually disappear even before we realize, because when the forest goes, the large carnivores that live there are finished, because they have nothing to eat. They will go and kill cattle and they don't die overnight. It's not like I kill a tree here and a tiger dies there. That soul is connected, but it's not connected like that. It is connected in a different way. So when the forest goes, tigers will have to rely on something else. The prey will drop, poaching will go up, and then they will go off a cattle, and then they will come into conflict. They will be poisoned or electrocuted and they will be gone. So climate change is going to put a huge amount of stress on the already existing problems. So I think, like we are now thinking about COVID and we are thinking what can we do to increase our capacity to earn money and how can we get the economy back. Similarly, think of COVID as a small baby of in front of a climate change situation. And if we can find solutions for COVID, we have to think in the same lines to fight climate change with a magnitude more effort put in by the technologists, by the economists, by the conservationists and the social scientists. So this is the biggest challenge that we have, and tiger is just, again, in this also just a metaphor. What happens to tiger is going to happen to us. If tigers are suffering now, human beings will suffer with a time lag of maybe 30-40 years, but it's going to be horrible. And when there is social unrest, women and children are the ones who are the biggest sufferer. During the social unrest, the poorest suffer more. Within the communities, women and children suffer more. So you can imagine the kind of inequity that will happen because of this. So I'm really, while I am a conservationist who thinks about tigers, but I don't really think in silos. I think tiger is just a barometer. And if we cannot find solutions for human greed and the strategy and the land use planning that we do, there's no point in having tigers around us. Tigers are basically the icing on the cake. We really don't have the cake in good shape. So that's my worry.
Thank you, Anish. What an amazing conversation, what an amazing presentation, and it's given us all so much to think about. Thank you.
Pleasure is mine.
So much.
India still has lions, tigers, elephants, rhinos, bears. It is simply a miracle. This is why we call it geopolitical outlier, but we may come back to it.